Chapter 16. Did you know ice fish in the Antarctic Ocean have their own antifreeze? If they didn't, they'd be ice cubes. And did you know it gets so cold down there that your skin would freeze in only a minute? Ben tries to look interested, but to tell the truth, he's sick of hearing about Ryan's geography report. The bus stops and a few kids get off. Ryan babbles on about Antarctic skuas and Adelie penguins. Ben is wondering how much longer it will take the bus to reach school when he hears a low chant coming from the back of the bus. Someone laughs. The chant gets louder. Ben can't make out the words, but he can tell that a few more kids have joined in. He turns around. Frankie Merley is in the back of the bus, leading the boys in the back seat in a dumb, sing-songy chorus. Captain Kidd and Snake Man, Captain Kidd and Snake Man, Captain Kidd and Snake Man. Ryan has finally heard it too. Frankie's such a jerk, he mutters to Ben. Before Ben can stop him, Ryan stands up in the aisle and shouts in the same sing-song way, Frankie's such a jerk, Frankie's such a jerk. He yells even louder than Frankie, and the kids on the front of the bus stop talking and turn around. When the bus slows down for the next stop, Frankie makes his way up the aisle and pushes Ryan back into his seat. Say that again, matey, he says, holding one hand over his eye like a patch. Ben's heart pounds. Stop it, he says. Oh, look, Snake Man can talk. Frankie turns around to make sure the other boys are watching. He makes a rattling sound with his mouse. Leave Ryan alone, says Ben. You started it with that stupid chant. What do you say, Captain? Do you want me to leave you alone? He tries to yank Ryan's glasses off, but Ben knocks his hand away. The glasses with the patch hang lopsided halfway down Ryan's nose. Ben has had it. Without thinking, he climbs over Ryan and lifts Frankie up by his jacket, pushing him back down the aisle. Hey! The bus driver shouts, enough of that, everyone in your seats. Suddenly, everyone is yelling and hooting. Leave him alone, Ben screams. Leave my friends alone. Ben's eyes fill with tears, but he doesn't care if anyone sees. He gives Frankie's jacket another shake and shoves him back in his seat. The bus driver pulls the bus to the curb and lurches down the aisle. You boys settle down or you'll be walking to school for the next month. Everyone on the bus is quiet now. Ben drops down in the seat next to Frankie. Sorry, he says to the driver. I'd better not hear another word out of you two. The bus driver glares at him and then returns to the front. As soon as the bus pulls away from the curb, Frankie snorts in disgust. I'm glad I'm moving. This school and all the losers in it like you stink big time. You're moving? Ben can't believe what he just heard. You're leaving when? This summer, Frankie says. I wish it was tomorrow. Who wants to live in this crappy town anyway? Ben tries to hide a smile. Good luck. What do you mean? Frankie says. I mean, good luck being the new kid in a different school. You better hope that wherever you move, the kids are nicer than you, because you can be a real creep. Yeah! Ryan is up on his knees, looking over the back of the seat. I hope the overtoad eats you up. Danny Martin chokes back a laugh. Frankie glowers at him, and Danny whirls around to face the front. Think about the word glowers there. So Danny is Frankie's friend, and he's laughing about something Ryan said that wasn't quite so nice about Frankie. What kind of look do you think Frankie gave Danny? Glowering is very similar to glaring, but it's a mean look, a very angry look. At the next bus stop, Ben heads back to his seat. One for the overtoad, he says to Ryan. Yeah, one for the overtoad. Ryan gives Ben a huge goofy grin and picks up his backpack. Gotta get off here, but I'll see you tomorrow, he says. We'll have a blast. See you, Ryan. Ben watches out the window as Ryan gets off the bus and heads around the street across the street to his house. Ben is still shaky inside from the encounter with Frankie, but he grins. He can feel people looking at him, but it doesn't bother him at all. Then, He remembers his geography report. His stomach rolls over once, then settles into a dull churning. Hey! His father is standing at the door of Ben's room. Agatha is beside him already in her pajamas. Hey, Ben says, placing his arm over the notes and desert pictures scattered on his desk. How's the report? Pretty good, Ben says, hoping that will be enough for his father. His dad plops down on his bed and pulls Agatha onto his lap. Ben cringes. This is not good. Your mom thought maybe we ought to take a look at it to see and see if we can help you finish it up. No, that's okay, Ben says. I can do it. Actually, I'd like to see it. It's quiet for a couple of seconds. Ben points to the papers on his desk. Here it is. Those look like notes. Can I see what you've written? I haven't really written much yet, Ben mutters. He fumbles for something else to say, knowing the truth is about to come out. To make matters worse, his mom sticks her head into the door. Bedtime, she says. Ben's showing Dad his report, Agatha says. Except he doesn't have it. Ben gives his sister a hard look. Why don't you go jump in a lake, he says. Because I don't want to, Agatha says. You're the one who's in Agatha. Enough. Dad lifts her off his lap and puts her on the floor. Have you written anything, Ben? Not much. Ben, you told us you were working on it and we trusted you, his dad says. Haven't you even started writing? Uh-oh, Agatha says. Now Ben's in trouble in a bunch of ways. Shut up, Agatha. Ben wants to strangle his little sister. What do you mean a bunch of ways? His mom asks. Should I tell them? Agatha keeps her eyes on Ben but edges closer to her mother. No, Ben says. Okay, says her father. What's happening? Ben got in a fight and almost got thrown off the bus. I did not. Did so. The bus driver says you're not supposed to fight on the bus, and you did. Agatha! Ben yells. Enough, their father says. Agatha, go with Mom. Agatha sticks her tongue out at Ben as Mom drags her to the door. Ben, what is going on with you? So much going on in his head that Ben doesn't even know where to start. Is this about Mrs. Tibbetts? His dad asks. Is that why you're not doing your work? No. Actually, is about Mrs. Tibbetts, but it's also about Frankie and Ryan and the Spadefoots and Mrs. Tibbetts' sister-in-law and the man from the National Heritage Program and being new. So as I look at that paragraph, the way it's written at first seems like all of that is something that Ben said to his family, but I look and I see those quotation marks. All Ben actually said was no. The rest is his thoughts. The quotation marks signal what Ben is saying. His father sits on the bed, holding his head in his hands and staring at the floor. Sorry, Dad, Ben says. His father looks up. What are you going to do about your report? It's Wednesday, and isn't it due on Friday? I'll finish it tomorrow, Ben says. Just make sure you get it done. His father stands and comes over to Ben's chair. Is there anything I can do to help? Ben shakes his head. I love you, pal, his dad says. I know. Thanks. It's torture getting through classes the next morning. Every time Ben thinks about his report, his stomach clenches up. While Mrs. Kutcher is writing something on the board, Jenny turns around in her seat. I heard about the fight, she whispers. It sure sounded like a fight. I notice Mr. Loudmouth is pretty quiet this morning. Ben looks back towards Frankie's desk. Frankie is staring straight at him, but he jerks his head down the moment Ben meets his gaze. Ben doesn't really care about Frankie. He's got more important things on his mind. The pool in the woods behind Mrs. Tibbetts' house is surely gone now, but he'll have to stop worrying about that problem and hope Mrs. Tibbetts can convince Mr. Lindsay that there really were Spadefoots in the pool. Now he needs to concentrate on his report. He can get more stuff off the internet, and after school he can go to the town library. He can even ask his mom or dad for help. He could draw a map of the area. Maybe he could pull it off. He feels better. He can do it. Ben crams his books and his desert note cards into his backpack. It's almost time for dismissal. Hey, Ben, Jenny says, looking back over her shoulder. Yeah? See you this afternoon. What for? You know, Ryan's party. What? Today is Ryan's party. I know he invited you. You're coming, right? Take a moment and think about that. Last time Ben didn't go to a party, how did Ryan feel? That wasn't even Ryan's party. Now how is Ryan going to feel? Ben remembers the party head invitation he stuffed under the papers in his desk. He feels like he might throw up. Is your mom bringing you over? I don't know. Ben stammers. I guess so. Okay then, see you there. Jenny disappears into the crowd of kids leaving the classroom. Ryan sits next to Ben on the bus. He's so excited about his party, he's talking even faster than usual. Ben smiles like he's listening, but his mind is all over the place, trying to figure out what to do. Ben finally interrupts the nonstop chatter. Ryan? Yeah? I can't come today. What? I'm sorry. I can't come to your party. I haven't done my report. I'm pretty much grounded until I finish it. I'm really sorry. But you said you were coming. You said my mom didn't need to call. I know I was coming. I totally forgot it was today. And if I don't get this report done, I'll be in big trouble. You've been working on that report for weeks. Can't you just finish it after the party? I can't. I barely even started on it. But my mom has already ordered the pizza and everything. It's okay. There'll be more for everybody else. Come on, Ryan. He said I'm really sorry. You'll have plenty of fun without me. Ryan turns his back to Ben and stares out the window. When the bus pulls up to Ryan's stop, he squeezes past Ben and trudges down the aisle. This is kind of a little lesson of something called procrastination. Procrastination means you put something off and you don't do it, and you wait until the last minute. When you procrastinate, things like this happen. I can relate to this right now in my own life because I'm working on a report, and if I procrastinate too much on it, I'm not going to be able to get it all done in one night. It's just not possible. So I need to space out my work and work a little bit each night to make sure I get the task done. If I try to cram it all into one night, I'm not going to get the grade I want, nor am I going to have time to really get it all done. Ben watches him as he steps onto the sidewalk. Ryan takes off his glasses and rubs his shirt sleeve across his eye. He glances up at the bus window. His lazy eye looks off to the left, like he's watching someone in the street, but the other one's straight at Ben, hurt and sad. At his stop, Ben climbs down from the bus and walks towards his house. Agatha trails along behind him. I know something you don't know, she sings. I know something you don't know. Ben tries to ignore her, but she sings it louder and louder. Finally, Ben turns to face her. Okay, already I give up. What do you know that I don't know? It's about Ryan's party, she says. What? Rory told me that you and Jenny are the only ones he invited. She says you're his only real friends. That's not true, Ben says. Yes, it is, she says. It's a secret. I'm going to the library to work on my report, Ben tells his mom. Don't you want a ride? She asks, looking up from her magazine. No, thanks. I'm taking my bike. It's not too far. Okay, she says. Work hard. Do you think Ben is really going to go to the library? Ben slips his backpack over his shoulders, climbs onto his bike, and pedals out in the driveway. 10 minutes later, he pulls up in Ryan's driveway and leaves his bike on the grass. When he knocks on the door, Rory opens it. Ryan! Jenny! She screams. Ryan! Ben's here! Ben hears someone running. He reaches into his backpack and pulls out Amphibians of the World. Ryan pushes Rory out of the way and swings the door wide open. Happy birthday, Ben says, holding out the book. Ryan's smile is so big it seems like it's going to fall off his face. Cool, he says. Cool, this is so cool. Ben peers through the kitchen window. His father is pacing back and forth, something he does when he's excited or upset. His mother is leaning against the counter with her arms folded. Ben takes a deep breath and opens the back door. "Is that you, Ben?" his mother asks. "Yeah," Ben calls, waiting for the axe to fall. "Where on earth have you been? I was ready to send your father out looking for you." "I've been at Ryan's house."
"Ryan's house? You said you were going to the library."
"I know," his father says. "You lied to your mother."
"I know. I'm sorry."
"You were supposed to be working on your report."
"But I had to go to Ryan's party. I promised him I would."
"Why didn't we know about this party?" his mother asks. "I forgot to tell you." His parents look at each other like their son has lost his mind. His father shakes his head and then squeezes the bridge of his nose with his fingers. "Go work on your report. We'll talk about your punishment tomorrow," his father says.
"But, Dad!"
"But nothing. Go to your room and get busy. Now, I don't know where all this lying is coming from, but it's going to stop." Ben's cheeks are hot. He doesn't blame his parents for being mad, but he was only trying to do the right thing.
"Dad!"
Agatha bursts into the room. Ben is about to tell her to get out, but he stops when he sees her face, all red and in a pout. She plants herself in the middle of the room, arms folded across her chest.
"I heard what you said. It's not fair," she said. "Ben was just being a friend."
"That's enough, Agatha," Dad says. "This doesn't have..."
"Why are you punishing Ben?"
"He messed up by not doing his report sooner, but Ryan doesn't have any friends besides Ben and Jenny, and isn't being a friend more important than finishing a dumb report?"
Ben stares at his sister, not sure that he heard her right.
"Ben has to make friends if he's going to live here. All his other friends are in Tucson," Agatha says. His parents are looking at each other. His father's mouth is all twisted, like he's trying not to smile. His mother looks away, like she doesn't want anyone to see what she's thinking.
Agatha? The twitty little sister breaks through the parent barrier, Ben thinks. It's a miracle.
"Well," his mother clears her throat, "even if that's true, you still have to do your report. You promised you'd get it done tonight." Somehow, in the smallest of ways, twitty Agatha has given Ben a little breathing space.
"Okay," he says.
And as he walks past his mom and dad, he can feel their eyes on him. When he passes Agatha, he motions for her to follow him. They walk down the hall together. At the door to his room, Ben turns and looks into his little sister's eyes.
"Thanks, Agatha," he says.
"Thanks a lot. You saved my butt in there."
"I know," she says. "I'm a good saver."
"Bring your reports up, please. Wait until I call your row." Mrs. Kutcher stands at the front of the class and watches as her students file up and place their reports on the big table under the bulletin board.
"Thank you, class. I appreciate all your hard work. I look forward to reading each one. Now I'd like you to sit silently for a few minutes and read tomorrow's assignment, pages 178 to 190.
When everyone is reading quietly, Mrs. Kutcher motions for Ben to come up to her desk.
"I didn't see you hand in a report, Ben. Did you forget and leave yours at home?"
"I didn't finish," Ben says, keeping his head down.
"Why not? I gave the assignment weeks ago."
Ben shrugs. "I just couldn't get it done."
"If you needed more time, why didn't you come to me sooner?"
Mrs. Kutcher leans on her desk. "Well, what are we going to do?"
"Maybe I could do it this weekend."
That doesn't sound very convincing. Suddenly, Ryan is at Ben's side. "Mrs. Kutcher," he begins. His voice is loud, like always. Other kids can hear him. It's embarrassing, but it's too late to stop him. Not that anyone could stop him anyway. "Ben wanted to do his paper, but he had to come to my party." "Do you think that Mrs. Kutcher is going to accept that excuse?" Mrs. Kutcher eyes Ryan and then looks back at Ben. Jenny appears on the other side of the table. Teacher's desk. "It's true, Mrs. Kutcher. Ben promised he would go to the party, and then he said he couldn't come because he had to do his report. Ryan was really disappointed." Mrs. Kutcher looks at all of them, then stares out the window for a moment, chewing on her bottom lip. Ben can't tell what she's thinking. "Ryan, Jenny, please go sit down," she finally says.
"Okay, but..."
Ryan starts. "Sit down, Ryan," Mrs. Kutcher repeats.
"Okay, okay."
Mrs. Kutcher waits until Ryan and Jenny are in their seats, then looks back at Ben.
You've known about this report for a long, long time. You even showed me some of your notes.
I know.
Why didn't you finish?
I don't know.
There must be some reason. You're so fascinated with the desert, and you already know so much about it.
I guess I've been doing other things, and the desert just isn't as interesting to me as I thought it was.
Why didn't you say something?
I don't know. I kept thinking I'd get the report done.
Mrs. Kutcher is quiet for a moment, then says, If you could pick another ecosystem, what would it be? Ben is afraid to say I don't know again. He stares at his feet.
I have an idea, the teacher says, and Ben looks up. He can tell by the tone of her voice it's something new, something different.
Why don't you write about a habitat around here? You're new in Massachusetts, and it might be interesting for you to find out about your new environment.
Ben is astounded. Mrs. Kutcher knows more about him than she thought she did.
Could she have been talking to Mrs. Timmons?
Like what? He asks.
Well, what do you think?
Wetlands, maybe? Swamps and ponds and marshes?
Sounds good to me, she says and smiles.
Okay, he'll have to start all over. But at least she's giving him a second chance.
And since you've changed topics, why don't I give you a week? It's still a lot of work to do in that time.
That's great, says Ben. He can feel that relief wash over him.
All right, 1 week, that's it. And remember, I'll have to deduct points because you didn't get it in on time.
Okay, thanks.
Ben rushes back to his desk before she can change her mind. Jenny's looking at him with an eager gleam in her eyes.
What happened?
She's taking off points, but she's giving me another week. I'm going to do my report on ponds and swamps here in Massachusetts.
Jenny holds up her hand for a high five.